On the evening of Friday, February 3rd, 2023, 38 of 149 cars of a Norfolk Southern Railway freight train derailed in East Palestine, Ohio. Five of the derailed cars were carrying vinyl chloride, a hazardous material that built up pressure in the resulting fires, eventually leading Norfolk Southern to vent and burn it in a bid to prevent an explosion. The ensuing fireball and cloud brought the normally unseen process of hazardous cargo transportation into a single chilling view, and the event became a lightning rod of controversy over rail industry regulations, federal involvement in chemical spills, and much more. I don't know about you, but in the flurry of political headlines and finger-pointing, I kind of lost the story of what actually happened. Freight trains, like the one that derailed in East Palestine, are fascinating feats of engineering, and the National Transportation Safety Board, or NTSB, and others have released preliminary reports that contain some really interesting details. I'm not the train kind of engineer, but I think I can help give some context and clarity to the story now that some of the dust has settled. I'm Grady, and this is Practical Engineering. In today's episode, we're talking about the East Palestine train derailment. Modern freight trains are integral to daily life for pretty much everybody. Look around you, and chances are nearly every human-made object you see has, either as bulk raw materials or even as finished goods, spent time on the high iron. One of the reasons trains are so integral to our lives is because there's nothing else that comes even close to their efficiency in moving cargo over land at such a scale. Steel wheels on steel rails waste little energy to friction, especially compared to rubber tires on asphalt. Locomotives may look huge, but their engines are almost trivial compared to the enormous weight they move. If a car were so efficient, its engine could practically fit in your pocket. And yet, the trains those locomotives pull are not so much just a vehicle as they are a moving location, larger and heavier than most buildings. With this scale in mind, you can see why the crew in a locomotive can't monitor the condition of all the cars behind them without some help. A rear-view mirror doesn't do you much good when part of your vehicle is a half hour's walk behind you. There was a time not too long ago when every freight train had a caboose. Part of their purpose was to have a crew at the end of the train who could help keep a lookout for problems with the equipment. Now, modern railways have replaced that crew with wayside defect detectors. These are computerized systems that can monitor passing trains and transmit an automated message to the crew over the radio, letting them know the condition of their train in real time.
CSX detector, milepost 756.8, you have a defect.
Defect detectors look for lots of issues that can lead to derailment or damage, including dragging equipment, overheight or overwidth cars, a hazard if the train will be passing through tunnels or under bridges, and, important in this case, overheating axles and bearings. Depending on the railway operator and line, these detectors are often spaced every 10 or 20 miles or 15 to 30 kilometers. The freight train that derailed in East Palestine, designated 32N, passed several defect detectors along its way, and the NTSB collected the data from each one. The suspected wheel bearing responsible for the crash was located on the 23rd car of the train. At milepost 79.9, it registered a temperature of 38 degrees Fahrenheit above the ambient temperature. 10 miles later, the bearing's recorded temperature was 103 degrees above ambient. That might seem kind of high, but it's still well below the threshold set by Norfolk Southern that would trigger the train to stop and inspect the bearing. 20 miles later, the train passed another defect detector that recorded the bearing's temperature at 253 degrees above ambient, greater than the 200-degree threshold, triggering an alarm instructing the crew to stop the train. But it was too late. Freight trains are equipped with a fail-safe braking system powered by compressed air. There are two main connections between cars on a train. One is the coupler that mechanically joins each car, and the other is the air line that transmits braking control pressure. As long as this line is pressurized, the brakes are released and the cars are free to move. But if one of these air lines is severed, like it would be during a derailment, the loss of pressure triggers the brakes to engage on every single car of the train. That's what happened shortly after the defect detector recorded the over-temperature bearing. When the defect detector notified the crew of an issue, they immediately applied the brakes to slow the train. But before they could reach a controlled stop, the train's emergency braking system activated. A security camera nearby caught this footage, showing significant sparks from what is presumably the failing car moments before the derailment. Understanding the severity of the situation, the crew immediately notified their dispatcher of a possible derailment. They applied the handbrakes to the two rail cars at the head of the train, uncoupled, and moved the two locomotives at the head end and themselves about a mile down the line away from the fire and damage, not knowing the events that would quickly follow. A train's consist defines the collection of cars that make it up. 32 N's consist included two locomotives at the head, a locomotive near the center of the train called distributed power, and 149 rail cars. 38 of those 151 cars had come off the tracks, forming a burning pile of steel and cargo. Of those 38 cars that derailed, 11 were carrying hazardous materials, including isobutylene, benzene, and vinyl chloride. Local fire crews and emergency responders worked to put out the fires and address the immediate threats resulting from the derailed cars. But despite the firefighting efforts, five of the derailed cars transporting vinyl chloride continued to worry authorities due to rising temperatures. Norfolk Southern suspected that the chemical was undergoing a reaction that would continue to increase in temperature and pressure within the tanks, eventually leading to an uncontrolled explosion and making an already bad situation much worse. The cars carrying vinyl chloride were DOT 105 tank cars. These are not just steel cylinders on wheels. The U.S. Department of Transportation actually has very specific requirements for tank cars that carry hazardous materials. DOT 105 cars have puncture-resistant systems at either end to keep adjacent cars from punching a hole through the tank. They have a thermal protection system with insulation and an outer steel jacket to protect against fires. They are tested to pressures much higher than they would normally see, and they include pressure relief devices, or PRDs, that automatically open to keep the tank from reaching its bursting pressure. The PRDs on some of the vinyl chloride cars did operate to limit the pressure inside the tanks, but the temperature continued to increase. As fires continued to burn, state and federal officials noted the temperature in one of the vinyl chloride cars was reaching a critical level. Rather than trust the PRDs to keep the tanks safe from bursting, they decided to perform a controlled release of the chemical to prevent an explosion. While they were still making the decision, the Ohio National Guard and the Federal Emergency Management Agency were running atmospheric models to estimate the extent of the resulting plume. Local emergency managers used these models to evacuate the area most likely to be affected by the release. On February 6th, crews dug a large trench in the ground, vented the five vinyl chloride tanks into the trench, and set the chemical on fire to burn it off. Despite being done on purpose to reduce the danger of the situation, the resulting fireball and pillar of smoke have become symbolic of the disaster itself. You might be wondering, like I did, why the controlled burn was necessary if the tank cars were fitted with PRDs. While the NTSB's full report hasn't been released yet, they have released some details about their inspections of the vinyl chloride cars. Three of the cars were manufactured in the 1990s with aluminum hatches that cover the valves, as opposed to the more updated standard steel hatches. During the initial fires and energetic pressure release, it seems that the aluminum may have melted and obstructed the relief valves, impacting their ability to reduce the building pressure. You might also be wondering why a train passing through a populated area would be carrying so much vinyl chloride in the first place. Vinyl chloride might sound familiar to some of you, as it's the VC in PVC. This channel makes a lot of use of PVC demonstrations. It's a material used in a lot of applications, so we produce it in vast quantities. And railways are usually how we move vast quantities of bulk materials and chemicals. But vinyl chloride is a toxic, volatile, and flammable liquid, not something you want a big pool of near your city. So officials decided to burn it off. Flaring or burning chemicals is a pretty common practice for dealing with dangerous gases or liquids that can't easily be stored. It's essentially a lesser evil, a way to quickly convert a hazardous material to something less hazardous, or at the very least, easier to dilute. While the byproducts of burning vinyl chloride are far from ideal, combusting it into the atmosphere was intended to be a way to quickly address the concern of it harming people on the ground or polluting a larger area. In fact, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency flew a specially equipped airplane after the burn-off to measure chemical constituents of the resulting plume. they found low detections of any chemicals of concern and concluded in their report that the controlled burn of the rail cars was a success. But success is a strong word for an event like this, and I might have chosen a different word. While there were no immediate fatalities resulting from the crash, the impacts are far-reaching. Chemical pollutants were not only released into the air, but also washed into local waterways during the firefighting efforts. Hazardous substances reached all the way to the Ohio River, and the Ohio Department of Natural Resources estimated that roughly 40,000 small fish and other aquatic life were killed in the local creek that flows away from East Palestine. Between the contamination of water and soil, it's impossible to say what the long-term impact on the local ecology will be. As for the residents, both the state and federal EPAs have been heavily involved in all aspects of the cleanup, monitoring air quality and water samples from wells and the city's fresh water supply. So far, they haven't detected any air quality levels of health concern after the derailment. As for the area's groundwater, out of the 126 wells tested, none have shown evidence of significant contamination. But, as you've seen in some of my previous videos, it can take a while for contamination to move through groundwater. The EPA has ordered Norfolk Southern to conduct all cleanup actions associated with the East Palestine train derailment. The company itself has pledged to meet or exceed regulatory requirements in regards to the cleanup. Cleaning up after such a disaster is no easy feat, from air, water, and soil testing to disposal of huge volumes of contaminated water and soil. The whole thing is a mess, literally. The cleanup is still underway as I'm releasing this video, but so far they've removed over 5,000 tons of contaminated soil and collected about 7 million gallons, or 26 million liters, of contaminated water from rain falling on the site and washing off trucks working on the cleanup. The response has been robust, but we know how these cleanups can go. The EPA's list of almost 1,800 hazardous waste sites of highest priority only has 450 examples of sites cleaned up enough to be taken off the list. The whole situation has also sparked policy discussions among several agencies. The NTSB is opening a special investigation into the safety culture and practices of Norfolk Southern, from congressional testimonials to public statements from the Department of Transportation to political posturing from a huge variety of public officials. One thing seems clear to me: this disaster will have an impact on the way railroading is conducted in America for years to come. The residents of East Palestine have a long road ahead of them. While all the preliminary testing so far paints a relatively safe and healthy picture of the town after the event, many have reported symptoms and effects. Even if there really are no residual compounds present at dangerous levels, the anxiety and unease of living near a high-profile chemical spill is hard to escape. The economic impact of just the perception of contamination is also very real, and things like home values and local agricultural businesses have already taken a direct hit. I live really close to a freight line myself, something that is a unique joy for my 2-year-old, but now when I see those tanker cars roll by, I can't stop myself from just wondering what's inside them and what might happen if they came off the rail in my neighborhood. But I also recognize that much of the lifestyle I enjoy depends on those trains rolling by my house. And despite the tragedy of events like East Palestine, the DOT recognizes rail transportation to be the safest overland method of moving hazardous materials. Even with the bulk of hazardous materials being transported over rails, highway hazmat accidents result in more than 8 times as many fatalities. So freight rail isn't going away anytime soon. It's the only feasible way to move the mountains of materials required for all the industries in the US, and really the world. And the fact that we rarely have to consider the incredible engineering details of tanker cars, defect detectors, and hazardous material cleanup operations is a testament to the hard work that goes into regulating and operating these lines. But freight rail in the US is unlike any other industry. There are only 7 companies that operate Class 1 railroads that make up the vast majority of rail transportation in the country. The U.S. rail market essentially consists of 2 duopolies, CSX and Norfolk Southern in the east, and Union Pacific and BNSF in the west. That gives these companies enormous political power, as we've seen in recent news. So we have to ask ourselves, are accidents like East Palestine, however rare they may be, just a part of doing business? Or is there more that could be done? And I think the answer in this case is clear. I expect we'll see some changes to safety regulations in the future to make sure something like this never happens again. and hopefully the next practical engineering video on railway engineering will have a more positive light.
Speaking of that next episode, if you grew up around when I did, you might have the same fondness for the great TV shows that used to run on the History Channel, Discovery, and the Science Channel. Now those networks mostly run reality shows like everything else, but hopefully you've noticed what's been happening with video over the past few years. I won't say it about myself, but I will say it about my fellow content creators. Independent producers like Brian from Real Engineering, Sam from Windover and Half as Interesting, Real Life Lore, and Johnny Harris are all making videos that are more fascinating and thought-provoking than any of the old TV shows that I miss. Sam's series Extremities about remote places on Earth just released this incredibly produced documentary on the Prudhoe Bay oil field in northern Alaska. It goes over the history, logistics, and great interviews with people who actually work on the North Slope. That video, along with a ton of other great content, is available exclusively on Nebula, the streaming platform built by and for independent educational creators, including me. Nebula is the answer to the question of what could happen if the best channels on YouTube didn't have to cater to an ad-supported algorithm, and it just keeps getting better and better. Totally ad-free videos from excellent educational channels, original series and specials that can't be found anywhere else, and even classes from your favorite creators like Devin from Legal Eagle and Thomas Frank. And right now you can pay just $30 for an entire year's access if you use my link in the description below. My videos go live on Nebula the day before they come out on YouTube, but even if you prefer just to wait for them here, a Nebula subscription is the best way to support my channel. If you use my link, a third of that revenue will go directly toward improving the quality and quantity of practical engineering videos. The rest goes toward adding new features and improvements to the Nebula platform. If watching videos like this one is what you do for fun or to relax, you should have the best viewing experience on the internet, especially when it's practically free like it is right now at the link below. Thank you for watching, and let me know what you think.